like you're naked. Oh, it's almost like we're sexing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, boo, I like it. No, I can't deny it. But I know you can tell I'm excited. Oh, girl.
Try to accomplish something that I haven't accomplished in a while, probably since last summer. And that's, I'm going to try to do a 15-minute video. 15-minute video. At top 20-minute video. You know, a lot of my critics and haters tend to say that, Alan, man, you know, your videos be too long. Although I mentioned that I haven't gotten that criticism since I started doing my timestamp feature. My timestamp feature. But speaking of my timestamp feature, I'm not going to do a timestamp for any video that's 39 minutes or less. 39 minutes or less. So I won't be doing a timestamp feature for this video. Wait, let me turn off my notifications. But yeah, a lot of people, before I start doing a timestamp, people used to say, man, you know, Ron Wheels, he does videos that are like roughly 15 minutes. AMS does videos that are roughly 15 minutes. Man, Alan, you be doing them hour-long videos, videos that last more than an hour and more than 45 minutes and so on. So, now actually, the reason why I almost have to do a video that's 15 minutes or less, because I got three Skype consultations back-to-back-to-back, Skype and telephone consultations back-to-back-to-back. So, literally, as soon as I finish this video, I got to go into doing three consecutive Skype and telephone consultations with clients. But the reason why I wanted to come with this quick video, because I heard from another critic. And now, speaking of that, somebody asked me, they said, and I've been asked this question before. They said, Alan, why do you even spend time addressing your critics? Wait, I'm moving my computer. That's why you see my, okay. Why do you even spend time, you know, offering responses and rebuttals to your critics and haters, critics and haters? Because I've just learned, starting going all the way back to my Blog Talk Radio days up until now, that you can change people's minds. A lot of people you won't change their mind. But some people you can. Some people you can. I'll give you two or three stories quick, real quick. Because again, I only got so many minutes. But yeah, I remember I had a guy from Switzerland. He was a credentialed, certified psychiatrist. And he told me, man, he wrote me an email saying when he first heard about me, man, he was a major hater of mine. He was a major critic of mine. He was basically like, man, I think Alan is full of shit. I think he's a snake oil salesman. And then he downloaded my book for free without paying for it. He down, you know, they have these, what's called torrent, T-O-R-R-E-N-T. Anytime you have a book in PDF form, what's known as Adobe PDF form, which is why I don't really like to use Adobe PDF. Once you come out with a book in PDF form, people just put it on a torrent site. And a lot of people will download it for free. And so he downloaded my Mode 1. I think first he downloaded Mode 1 Hardcore, and then he downloaded the regular Mode 1 version. And again, this guy, by his own admission, he said he was a major hater and critic of mine. Do you know what this guy ended up doing? A few months after he read my book, man, and saw that I knew what I was talking about, he actually sent me $250 via PayPal. That's way more than the price of my two books, Mo 1 Hardcore and Mo 1. Yeah, he ended up sending me $250 through PayPal because he said my books had helped him that much. And again, this wasn't no just regular guy living in his mom's basement. This guy was a credentialed psychiatrist in Switzerland. And yeah, man, so that's one example of a guy who went from being a hater and harsh critic of mine to being a fan of mine. There's a guy, who was that? Somebody that's well-known in the manosphere that is escaping me right now. But I'll just say in general, I've had a few people who were really popular in the manosphere that initially were haters and or critics of mine that later on became, and I know I now affectionately call him Lil Bruh. I'm going to highlight a young brother who's got his YouTube channel going big time. It's growing. C Boogie. You usually see him in my comments section. C Boogie. And he'll tell you himself. C Boogie used to be a critic of mine. I don't know if I would call him a real harsh critic of mine. I would never categorize him as necessarily a hater of mine or a harsh critic of mine. But at minimum, he was like at least a mild critic of mine. I met him on Mumia Obsidian Ali's, one of his live streams, about, I want to say, roughly almost a year ago. And it was the first time we crossed paths with each other. And yeah, man, C Boogie, he used to challenge me on a lot of stuff, man. Matter of fact, I did one video where I did a response to something he said about me. He called me one of those select niggas. That's what he referred to me as. He said, Alarise Currie, one of them select niggas, man. That's in reference to Ron Wills' vernacular of select men versus non-select men. Select men versus non-select men. But yeah, C Boogie, man. And now I got to give him props, man. He gives me a lot of dap on his channel, man, which I appreciate. And I want to publicly give him a shout out for that, man. He gives me a lot of dap now on his YouTube channel, man. You know, matter of fact, he did a video talking about being a dominant man with women. And he gave me like two or three shout outs in his video, which I appreciated. Because, you know, as most people know, I'm a professional BDSM dominant sir. And just in my personal life, I've been a dom for years. And yeah, he gave me a shout out. So anyway, my point was, he was somebody that used to be at least a minor critic of mine, but now, you know, me and him are pretty cool, man. You know, he's like, I consider my little younger brother, even though in terms of our age difference, he's almost young enough to be my son more so than my younger brother. Because I'm 55 and I think he's 30. See, Boogie's about 30, no more than 31 or 32. So you're talking about, man, we got like about 23 to 25 year difference between us. But anyway, yeah, man. So to address the question somebody posed to me, Alan, why do you spend a lot of time offering responses and rebuttals to your haters and critics? Because I always feel like I could change somebody's mind. But anyway, my time is limited. Matter of fact, let me look at the clock. Okay. I got about 11 minutes. Here's what was posed to me. Somebody sent me an email. They said, they made the statement, ARC, one thing I don't like about you dating coaches and PUAs is that you give men a misleading impression that you can teach attraction. You can't teach attraction. That is bullshit. That's why a lot of us call you guys snake oil salesmen, because you guys try to act like you can teach attraction. Either a woman is attracted to you or she's not. You can't teach a man to be more attractive to women.
Insert dog face here.
I hate to tell you this, young man, but that's not 100% true. That's not 100% true. Now, in your partial defense, I would say that's at least partially true. I'll say, here's the part where I would address that. I would say you're partially correct. And I've said this before. If you're a man who's just simply not a woman's type, you're just simply flat out not a woman's type, then for the most part, your assessment is correct. It ain't too much. For example, I don't know. Let's say you're an Asian male that's 5'8", and you're talking to a white woman who loves blonde surfer types who are 6'2" or taller with blonde hair and blue eyes. Yeah, it's pretty much nothing I can do to help that Asian guy pull that white woman if she's into blonde surfer types. Because everybody has a type. Just about all men have a type. Most women have a type that they prefer to hook up with. So if you're just flat out not someone's type, then that's when I would agree with this guy who wrote me this email and say, it ain't too much you can do. But to suggest that you can't give people, men, advice on how to enhance their romantic appeal to women or sexual appeal to women, nah, that's false. That's false. I wouldn't be in business if that was true. Plain and simple. I wouldn't be in business if that was true. You know, I've been in business as a dating coach since, I've been a book author since, 1999 officially. I've been a dating coach since 2007, and I've mentioned this before. Do you know my income has increased every year except for one, starting with 2007? My income as a dating coach and book author has increased every year except for 2014. That's the only year I had like a minor regression, was 2014. Every other year, starting with 2007, I've made more money than I did the previous year. Like, for example, recently, I made more money in 2018 than I did in 2017. I made more money in 2017 than I did in 2016. I made more money in 2016 than I did in 2015. Oh, speaking of that, I had my second best month of audiobook sales ever in December. December of 2018 was my second best month of audiobook sales ever. And I bring that up to say, if I was such a snake oil salesman, why is my business continuing to grow? Why is my business continuing to grow? Why am I attracting more and more clients? Like, in the last 2.5 years, man, I've had more one-on-one face-to-face coaching session clients than I have in my entire career. Starting with, roughly summer of 2016 up until now, I've had my highest number of one-on-one face-to-face coaching session clients. Matter of fact, as you know, I just got back from Los Angeles working with two guys, one-on-one face-to-face coaching session clients. You can do things to help men enhance. Here's the biggest thing I do. And like I said, I got to keep watching the clock because, now I got about 6 minutes. This is going to be one of my shortest videos. I've done a handful of videos that were 20 minutes or less. I think at most I've done maybe 6 or 7 videos, not including Patreon exclusive videos that were 20 minutes or less. This is going to be one of them. But I'll tell you the main thing I do as a dating coach. The first thing I do is I identify a man's fears. What are his fears? That's the first thing I identify when I work with clients. What is that man's fears? What is his egotistical insecurities? What is his invalid beliefs and ineffective attitudes? What aspects of his parental upbringing and cultural conditioning has affected positively and or negatively affected his behavior? As you know, I call the collective sum of all those factors your social programming. Your social programming. I've been using that term for about 2 decades now. Matter of fact, I heard C Boogie use that term in his video just the other day. Social programming. Yeah, man. I remember when I used that in London in 2010, people were like, what? Social programming. Social programming, man. But that's what your social programming is. The collective sum of your fears, your egotistical insecurities, your invalid beliefs and ineffective attitudes, and your parental upbringing and cultural conditioning. All that combined together, I refer to as your social programming. Your social programming. That's the main thing I work on with men. There's a few things I work on with men, but the main thing I work on with men, at least the starting point, is I identify what that man, because one of the number one things that holds men back and negatively affects their social skills and their conversation skills with women is the flaws of their social programming. The flaws of their social programming. And my simple thing is this, man. Why do so many of you guys focus on what you can't achieve with women? That's what I want to know. That's a question I want to pose to you guys. Why? And I talked about this when I spoke in Berlin, Germany. I spoke in Berlin, Germany in April of 2013 or May. One of those two. It was either April, May of 2013. I had a great time in Berlin. Matter of fact, I ran into a guy who recognized me on the street. That was so weird. I was just out on the street and a guy recognized me in Berlin, Germany. He said, "You're Alan Roger Currie." But one of the things I talked about, if anybody's seen my speech from Berlin, Germany, is that I meet so many guys, y'all always focus on what you can't do with women instead of focusing on what you can do. A lot. That's why I like to share a lot of my seduction stories with guys, is to show you what's possible. Like, if you had told me a few days before I got my dick sucked in a grocery store that was going to happen, I might have been like, "Ah, man, get out of here." So you telling me I could have a woman on her knees in the aisle of a grocery store sucking my dick. But I did it. I did it. I had a woman in a grocery store, a public grocery. Now, it wasn't in the middle of the day. It was like about 1:30, 2 a.m. in the morning. It was a 24-hour grocery store. But still, I had a woman on her knees in a grocery store sucking my dick. I bet most of you guys think, in your mind, you think that's impossible to achieve. Verbal seduction story number one, and who said it again? I had a woman that started out being just a straight up bitch with me, and then less than an hour later, this woman was behaving like she was my personal sex slave. Most of y'all would, in your mind, y'all would be like, it's impossible to get a woman to go from being a straight up, smart, elicky, loud talking bitch to an obedient, submissive, personal sex slave. But I did it. Verbal seduction story number six, and who said it again? I helped a buddy of mine score a threesome with two women that not only didn't know each other, which is very challenging, these two women didn't know each other, and initially, they didn't even like each other. But I achieved that. I helped a buddy of mine have a threesome with two women who didn't know each other and didn't like each other. Go, if you haven't heard that story, go read it or listen to it in the audiobook. Verbal seduction story number six. And I could go on down the list, man. I've achieved a lot of things with women that on paper would make guys say, "Oh, that's impossible." Or, "I can't, you know, you won't, no guy would be able to achieve that." You guys have a lot of negative beliefs, man. Oh, shoot. Got to wrap up. So, yeah, man, I disagree with that. You can give men advice related to helping them enhance their romantic appeal or strictly sexual appeal in the eyes of a, you know, in athletics, they used to say you can't teach speed. You can't teach natural athletic talent. But is that to say that Randy Moss didn't need a good coach? Is that to say Tom Brady didn't need a good coach? Is that to say Michael Jordan and Kobe Bryant didn't need a good coach? Coaching is always important. Michael Jordan is one of the most naturally gifted athletes in the history of the NBA, but he still needed a good coach to win championships. Alan Roger Currie, I'm out.
Making me want you, but I can't fight it all the way. Yes, sir.
Say it again.
Yes, sir.
Who's the king?
Alan, you're the king.
Say it again.
Alan, you're the king. You're dominating me.
Say it again.
Alan, you're dominating me right now. Mode one.
Mode one.
Daddy, can I go, please? You're the king.
Say it again.
Oh, you're the fucking king. Yes. Yes. Yes.
You're the king, Alan.
A.K.A. the king of verbal seduction. You know, it's the tone of your voice, how seductive your intonations are, the vibrations that you could just reach out over the phone lines and stroke a woman's breast just by the sound of your voice, how you could make her pussy so wet just by the sound of your voice. That's actually very hot.
So you said my show was what?
I said your show is powerful.
Oh, say it again.
Your show is powerful.
I bet the king would fuck me really good.
Oh, yeah. Who's the king?
Alan Roger Currie.
Oh, yeah. Who's the king?
Alan Roger Currie. The king.
The king.
The king.